So I wasted a couple of days cutting out some aluminium plates really, really slowly, and in the end I noticed they were quite skew, and what I had cut out was completely useless to me. The Y plates were not running parallel on my CNC machine. One side was about 4 mm behind the other, so I ended up with trapezoidal instead of square plates. I think what had happened was at some point the Y plate had reached their limit, which is only on one side, and as I don't have physical hard limits, while one side crashed into the proximity sensor, the opposite side kept going that little bit more. Stupidly, for whatever reason, maybe I had to rush off and forgot about it, it didn't occur to me that this would mean I would have to square the gantry again, but I had to and I didn't. Anyway, let's look at the positives. I just cut a load of aluminium. That's an achievement in its own right. My feed rate was 230 mm a minute with a step down of 0.25 mm and a plunge rate of 80 mm a minute with the spindle running at 15,000 RPM. Well, that's what I thought I was doing, but my acceleration is quite slow and this actually affects the final speed I end up cutting at, depending on the particular shape and the toolpath I've selected. I'm going to come back to this later on in the video. Anyway, I decided I should add some kind of physical hard stop to the y-axis, which is going from the front to the rear of the machine, so that if I accidentally crashed the gantry into the end plates again, at least it will stop at the same position. Okay, I made a massive cock up. I think what had happened on the CNC machine was the two Y plates were not square, so they were kind of off a little bit. On a positive, I've obviously managed to cut some plates out, which is a miracle, and in fairness, the cut doesn't look too bad, but I have wasted the material when the bottom is lined up and this plate has been flipped. I've literally got a gap on this side of about a mil and a bit, and because of that, it means what should be a circle here, how I've orientated the pivot holes and everything, is now elliptical, and one ellipse is going this way and the plate underneath is going that way, and essentially these plates will not pivot. So with the design I've made, it's really, really, really important that the CNC machine is properly squared. I actually trammed the spindle so that I compensated for the nod and also the tilt in this direction along the x-axis here, but what I didn't do, which I forgot to do, which was very stupid, was to move these back into a position so that they were parallel to each other. So what I could do is just take a bit of 12 mm threaded rod and screw it in on this section here, so that if the gantry was to butt into the proximity sensor on this side, it would hit onto the opposite side at the same amount. I'm not really sure I should be using the proximity sensor as a physical stop as well though, although I have managed to ram the gantry into it a few times. I want to add a machine screw like this one here somewhere on the plate so that the Y plate here, when moving into this direction, has a physical stop. I think realistically it makes sense to place this so it makes contact with the bottom of the plate there, down here, but obviously I don't have this material there on the opposite plate. So now I'm thinking actually I should just stick with this plate type variety and get rid of the back completely so there isn't that option essentially. So I'm just in the sketch for the motor plates. What I've done is I created a circle which is the diameter of the coupler, that's 19 mm. I'm also going to do another circle which is 25, because you can get fixed couplers which are a bit larger. 25 work, goddammit. So I've got a visual reference of what I need to avoid. Now I'm going to make a random hole, which would be the same size as the M5 tap hole, which is 4.2. And what I've done is I've already worked out the spacing based on the actual model. So I created a sketch somewhere else in this Fusion document, positioned a hole and basically did the same thing superimposed on the model so I could see where I needed to put this. So I know that if I click on the center of that to there, so I'm going to be able to see this hard stop X is going along the X axis, and that's moved in. Now I'm going to do the same thing, 1, 2, and this is going to be the Y
One, two, three. Oh, stop. So this is basically, this hole now is a quarter of the way down from the face of the plate that will be coming towards it on the Y plate. So that's the new design change. And I think what I'm going to have to do as well is get rid of these plates here, because as you can see there's no material there to place a machine screw like this, so it just makes sense to mirror all those parts. So I have two at the front and two at the back. So the next thing I'm going to do is square the gantry. This is not to be confused with tramming, which is aligning the spindle along the X and Y axis so it doesn't travel while moving along the Z. Squaring the gantry is a little bit simpler. I drilled four holes ever so slightly larger than 6mm and used these broken carbide bits, which I pushed into the openings and measured between each corner. If the gantry is square, the space between opposite corners should be the same. Okay, that's 15170. And that's 15167. So it's okay. It's square now. They were pretty much bang on. I had actually already checked the distance between the front plates and the Y plates with a vernier caliper, turning off the controller temporarily and manually adjusting one side by rotating the coupler until the distances were the same.
7565, and that's 7569.
Anyway, it's square now. I mentioned earlier that the acceleration affects the overall speed. While cutting on BCNC, there is a live reading of the feed rate, and depending on your acceleration and the geometry of the vectors, well, in my case, I noticed that sometimes I would not even reach the speed I had set. So what I've done is, in the Tools tab and in the controller menu, I changed the acceleration of the X and Y axis from 10 mm a second to 35. I then screwed down one of the wasted skewed plates so I could recut out the bottom Z plate and try and use up some of the scrap material.
So what I'm going to do is try and follow some of the tool paths to make this plate now that the gantry's square. I should be able to fit it right across there so I don't waste this plate. But what I'm going to do
is use this button here.
When I built this machine, I added this toggle switch, which allows me to go between the speed set in the G-code and to set it manually using this potentiometer.
So mid-cut, I can press that button and change the spindle speed by hand, twizzling the potentiometer. You can also do this in BCNC with the toggle bar, but only once you have upgraded to Gerbil 1.1. Alongside this, you can also increase the feed rate plus or minus 100%. This is an interesting feature because it means while you are cutting, you can push and tweak your tool path until the cut sounds and looks right. I guess what would make this even better is if the spindle speed automatically adjusted depending on the feed rate, if you could set a range for this type of operation, but this is a little beyond my ability to program. Drilling the 5.1mm hole sounded a lot better through the ear defenders. In the end, while the holes came out in the correct position, I could tell they weren't perfect. The larger holes, however, cut like a dream and the speed was ridiculous. While I set the feed for the smaller holes to 450mm a minute, the real-time feed rate indicated on BCNC actually oscillated between 100 and 150mm a minute. Clearly, I think it's worth going even slower than that. The feed for the larger bearing holes was another story. I managed up to 750mm a minute there. While cutting the outer vectors, I reached 855mm a minute, which is ridiculously fast for aluminium. I was using isopropanol as a coolant, but when I began to run out of that, I moved over to methylated spirit. That evaporates very quickly and helps to keep the aluminium cool. I would also periodically check the temperature of the aluminium using my laser temperature measurer. So I think in future I'm going to definitely spot mark the smaller holes and draw those out on the pillar drill, and only use the single flute cutter for larger, more complicated shapes which I can't do by hand. I also think I'm going to simplify the design of the pivoting plate and remove the fine adjustment mechanism. The fact of the matter is most hobby machines don't have an adjustment for the tilt along this axis. My machine with its pivot holes already means that if I were to require tramming the CNC machine, I will not have to take the machine apart, and that's already a massive design improvement.
So it definitely looks a lot more square than the first plates. I'm just going to go clean this up now. Okay, so I've just put the bottom Z plate on and it feels really good. I can tell just by rubbing my finger on the sides and against the extrusion that it feels quite square. The holes were a little bit larger at the top. I think I need to tone down the tool path. But considering everything, what I've just had to go through, this is a great success.
Anyway, that was a bit of a mental video. I've learnt a lot about working with aluminium on a CNC machine, and I really can't wait to cut out the new plates and rebuild this machine with its new features, and so that it's a lot more rigid. Anyway, don't forget to sacrifice a thumb and let me know what you think in the comment section below, and you'll see me in the next one. Thanks again.